Adam today will share his personal experience in joining the radical experiment, right? So a one-year journey in authentic discipleship that transformed how we live in a world that desperately needs the good news. And very true that Jesus came to bring, all right? So Jesus came to seek and seek the lost, right? So Adam is a regional president of FGBMFI Indonesia and in Australia and in New Zealand. Wow. So he has been in garment printing business for many years in Sydney. He has a degree in computer science. He's an alumni of Mount Carmel School of Ministry and also alumni of Halftime Institute. Brother Adam, do you know that, you know, many years ago, I grabbed hold of this book called Halftime, and it changed my life, and I've given that book to many people who have changed their life as well. So forward to you, Brother Adam.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thanks, Raymond. Let me open with the statement. God never demands us to give what we do not have, but he cannot use what we will not give. Let me introduce. My name is Adam Tedja. I was born in Bandung, Indonesia. I've been living in Sydney for 38 years. It's so great to be in this meeting. I do have a long association with Malaysian brothers and sisters in Sydney. Actually, after I encountered Jesus, I was mentored by Malaysian brothers in our church, in small group, and also in the Full Gospel Chinatown chapter. So I feel really home to be in this Zoom meeting. Thank you, Brother Ray, for inviting me. I really love Brother Ray. His voice, he's got that radio voice. Amazing. I love your voice. Thank you also for Sebastian Chung, for the worship, for prayer, Stephen Toh. I can see that some of our brothers from Australia also joining us. I can see the president of the Full Gospel Chinatown, Sam Ng. I think he's here somewhere. We also have Len Donaldson and Rod Winter. Thank you, everyone, for your support. I can't check who's just logging in just now. But honestly speaking, I feel quite nervous, especially knowing the track record of many of your previous speakers in this chapter. Last week, I found myself actually on the side of the road. I stopped the car and I started to weep when I heard that amazing testimony of great love of Jesus to our brother Tony and sister Ashley Low. I'm really looking forward for that second part of that sharing. And also, here many weeks before, we heard of testimony of Brother Lorenzo Porricelli from Hollywood. We heard that powerful reflection from Brother Roger Lam from Hong Kong. I have to say, you know, I love the variety and the depth of the sharing in this group. Truly uplifting, truly encouraging, powerful. And the most important, it's very addictive, you know. That's why I keep on coming back every week. So I really hope that my sharing will not be the one that stopped the momentum. So I hope that my sharing also bring impact to you all. So before I start, let me just ask, how many of you are actually the happiest man on earth? I just want to see your hand. Come on. Wow, I can see. Yes, yes. Amazing. All right. We've got a lot of happiest men, people on earth here. So for the rest of you who didn't put your hands up, I believe that you will be. You will be very soon. Okay, let me just share now. Now, before I share, can I just share one screen very quickly? All right, let me just share a screen. Now, what I'm sharing here is just combination of book, combination of thing that make up this testimony, right? So I do show the book of the Bible, obviously, the book of Radical by David Platt, and the book that Brother Raymond mentioned, Hard Time, really one that changed my life. Also a book written by Richard Stern, The Hole in the Gospel. And also one book from John Piper, What Jesus Demands from the World. I want to make sure that I share this because you might say, I heard this before. Yes, it's probably from that book. Okay, So my faith journey actually started in 2009. At that time, I wasn't a believer then, and somehow there's a lady from Singapore who came, and they organized the church camp, and my wife was in that church camp, and somehow after that, they decided to open up or to have a meeting in my house. I actually refused, and I said, no, don't do that. Don't do a meeting in our house. It's a bit awkward. I have this altar full of statues of things that I worshipped previously, you know, and they said, no, we're going to have a meeting in our house. So I actually tried to hide, but they called me in. And the thing is, that was the first time I actually joined what Christian meeting. First time that I joined worship, there was prayer and there was a sharing of the word of God. And when the meeting finished, this lady from Singapore, she called me and said, look, you know, I believe, you know, in the Bible, in Acts 16:31, they believe that if one person is saved in the family, the whole household will be saved. And she asked, would you want to accept Jesus? And I thought, okay, that's a bit awkward. That's a bit unusual. So I said to her, look, no, I don't. And then after that, not long after that, she came back to me again. And she said, Adam, you know, tell you the truth. We are here because I received a vision. I received a vision that today is the day when you will receive Jesus. Would you want to know that Jesus? And I, again, this time I said, no, I politely say no. And then for the third time, she came back to me. That was the time just before she left. She pushed me, she get a bit violent. She pushed me in the kitchen and she said to me, Adam, when God speaks to me, I never heard wrong. Today is the day you will receive Jesus. Again, this time I got really, you know, very uncomfortable. I said no again. She, obviously, she was disappointed. My wife was disappointed. My daughter was disappointed. So they're all gone. So I had the time to kind of reflect what really, really happened. And then I called my daughter and my wife, and I said, look, something happened. When you guys worshiping, you were singing this song, and I sang along with it. The song is called Hosanna. And all of a sudden, you know, my eyes were open, and everyone in that meeting disappeared. In front of me, standing, exactly what that song is saying, I see the King of Glory. And I saw the King of Glory standing right in front of me, you know, so majesty, so bright. But the odd thing is, next to this King of Glory, there's this being in his meditation position, is actually Buddha. And the King of Glory extended his hand, helped Buddha to stand up. They both look at me for a moment, and then after that, I saw Jesus let go of Buddha's hand. Buddha turned around and walked away. And I thought, wow. I didn't know what to respond. I just thought, wow, that is something that I never expected. But really, you know, when I reflect on that moment, I remember after that, my wife and my daughter was crying, and my daughter said, that is time for you to receive Jesus. You know, without me realizing that night, when I actually called Hosanna, I actually called Jesus. When I sang that word, heal my heart and make it clean, without realizing that I actually asked for forgiveness to God. I asked to heal my heart and make it clean. And that night, I asked God to open up my eyes. When I say, open up my eyes to the thing unseen. That moment, my life completely changed, transformed. The next day, I got rid, you know, the next few days, I got rid of all of my statue, and I was so much on fire. And then I actually joined up this the Full Gospel Businessman Chinatown chapter, and they really pretty much bringing me in. But then our church, I actually go to Wesley International Congregation in Sydney. At that time, we were doing this experiment based on the book by David Platt. The book is called Radical. So we were doing a radical experiment. Every week we have to do something that's quite unusual according to the book. And that week we were doing what the experiment is saying. Can you give 2% of your time in a completely different context? So the pastor asked us to close our eyes and pray. And I did that. And I felt, you know, I have that urge and I have that desire to give that 2%. So I stood up and opened my eyes. My wife also stood up next to me. So praise the Lord. We both a call to go. So we were praying about it, and at the end we ended up going to a place in China. We were this was my first mission trip ever, and really it's something that completely changed my life. You know, that morning, I remember that Monday morning, we were in this orphanage, government orphanage. This is the government orphanage that work very closely with an organization in Australia called Heart for Kids. Heart for Kids receive children that the orphanage cannot look after. So we have the access to go into that place. So that morning, I was taken to this room, probably about 4 by 5 meters. And inside that room, there were about 18 baby cots. Inside that baby cot, there were 3 babies. You know, like we were told that there was 3 things that we have to remember. Number one, we don't cry. Number two, we don't take picture. Number three, when we pick up the baby, we make sure that we put the baby back where we found it. Because there was no label, nothing, no tag or anything. There's a small plastic bag above the head of this baby. It's something that the parent probably left, like maybe a note or something. But what we found is every single baby are handicapped, you know, from very simple, maybe missing a finger or missing a toe or cleft lips and all that. But there are some that's quite intense where the size of the head was probably 3 times than a normal baby. There's one that the face is facing north, but the leg is facing south. So we were holding it and I was just so broken. And I really remember, you know, the song that I sang, you know, the Hosanna, that God break my heart for what break yours. And really that moment, it really, really break my heart. You know, that whole week, you know, the first day we were at that baby orphanage, that morning, that place received 18 new babies. So they have in front of the orphanage, they have the baby drop-off point where anyone, any parents can just drop their baby there and just leave them for the government to look after. It was really breaking our heart. The second day, we actually see the whole spectrum of abandonment from baby, from toddler, from young, from old, until the adult that they're no longer able to look after. You know, I came back from the mission. I'm pretty much broken. And I kind of thinking, no, this is not for me. Really, this is not for me. I'm not built for it. Then to justify myself, I joined, I found that book, you know, like Raymond found that book, Half Time, read the book, and I was so inspired by it, by that book. Then I joined the Half Time Institute. It's just a whole process, the whole year where we trying to find the significance in the eye of God. So we spend month after month with 10 other people. We create our roadmap, we plan our second half time, we explore our heart, we explore our head, and just trying to see and find the clarity. What is it that God wants me to do? But again, you know, the second year, I do want to give another 2% of my time. I ended up exploring, is there any possibility for Heart for Kids to serve in India? So we went there and we found, yeah, there is a organization we can work with. I went there to have a look and just to see and explore how we can do it. And then the third year, we actually went and brought the whole team with us. I'd like to share a small video, if I may, just so you have some ideas what it is that we actually do during that mission. I'm just trying to see how I get to open that. Bear with me.
That you know, Brother Adam is in the cafe where he's going to have the next FGB meeting. So he's near the kitchen. There's also a hissing sound coming out from the kitchen.
So I'm sorry, just trying to find where the share button is. Okay, I found it. Okay, I'm going to share sound. I'm going to, all right. Are you able to see that video? No, yeah, hang on.
Picture, yeah.
Okay. All right. Kind of fell. Let me find that file. Bear with me for a second. Sound on?
Yes.
I've got a demons that won't let me sleep. By eating this fruit, yeah, really good. See his expression.
Yum.
Last picture that you saw, his name is Lucky. Lucky is very lucky. The orphanage found him in the kitchen, in the market. He's a wild kid. He was abandoned by his parents. He's one of the 4 million children that is abandoned or live on the street in India. Lucky is truly a very wild kid. To defend himself, he used his claw, he bite, and he slept on top of the tree at night. So when Lucky was taken to the orphanage, he was so shocked. He was so shocked to find that he actually met his sister. His sister was actually also abandoned. They found his sister in a village quite far away. So I guess the parents got rid or abandoned both their children, one in one market, the other one in another village. So yeah, lucky is a lucky boy. So one day, you know, when we were there, we took all these 100 kids to cinema. I don't know if you guys know this movie called Bahubali. So we went and blocked the whole cinema. We actually watched the movie together. For some of them, this is their first experience. Can you imagine how happy they were? And we also took them to entertainment park. We took them to the beach. And in the beach, all of a sudden, you know, that afternoon, the weather that was hot all of a sudden turned into cold. Lucky, we saw from the corner of my eyes, he was shivering. He was so cold. But Lucky doesn't know where to go. He just doesn't know. He doesn't know whether he needs to turn to anyone. So my friend, one of the team members, saw that, and she grabbed the big towel and wrapped that towel around him and gave him a hug. And that was the moment that is so touching, because we saw that expression of Lucky. He doesn't even know how to receive love. He doesn't even know how to react when someone loves him. And I remember at that time, all the member or our team member, the people there, everyone had their tears in their eyes. You know, in the world, according to the statistic, in year 2020, there are about 800 million people that go hungry at night. That is 100 million more than 2019. So at this time, I have a moral question for all of us. In the face of all this human suffering in our world, what is our responsibility as followers of Christ? Do we have an obligation to act? What does God expect from us? John Piper wrote a book titled What Jesus Demands from the World. There were 50 demands. All demands were biblical. All demands are valid. Let me take one of the demands. This is demand number 8. Take up your cross and follow me. The question is, are you willing to follow him and accept God's will for your life? Though whoever wants to come after me must deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. What does it mean for us to embrace this gospel of Jesus Christ in the 21st century? Most of us who have accepted the Lord Jesus understand that the good news that Christ died for our sins, and that we can now be united with God. And then we focus on spreading the good news to others. But you see, this is actually a very limited view of this wonderful gospel. We call our friends to hear the good news and accept Lord Jesus as if we sell this ticket that guaranteed to be accepted in heaven. People flock in to buy the tickets or this insurance. And then after that, they go home. They put the tickets or insurance in the drawer and they back partying without any life changes or doing anything else with them. Is that God? Is that all God wants from us? Go to church on Sunday, read the Bible, pray before eating. Does God expect more from us? The answer, which probably are the strongest, come from Matthew 25. I know most of you already know, but I'd like to read it again. This is when Jesus described the final judgment at the end time, and I will read it now. Then the king will say to those on his right hand, come, those of you who are blessed by my Father, enter into the kingdom that was prepared for you from the beginning of the world. For when I was hungry, you gave me food. And when I was thirsty, you gave me water. I am a stranger, you receive me in your home. I am not clothed, you give me clothes. I am sick, you guys take care of me. I am in prison, you help me. Then the people will say, Lord, when have we seen the Lord hungry and then we fed the Lord and thirsty and we gave the Lord a drink? When have we seen the Lord as a stranger? Then we welcome the Lord into our home. When has God ever been unclothed and we gave God clothes? When have we seen the Lord sick or in prison and then we help the Lord? The king will reply, know this. When you do this, even to one of my brethren who is despised, you are doing it to me. You see, this is like the sign of the kingdom of God. These are the hallmark of true followers of Christ. Here we are told that when we show God's love to the least and the lost, we are actually doing it for Christ himself. But I want you to listen a slightly different version of Matthew 25. And you probably, some of you probably have seen it, have heard it, this different version in the book called The Hole in the Gospel. Let's hear if this sounds familiar to you. Is this you? Is this your friend? Or is this your church people or the FGB men that you know? It sounded like this. Because when I am hungry, you ordered food as much as you like through Uber Eats. Because when I'm thirsty, you shook your feet, or in Malaysia, goyang kaki, you click, click, your bubble tea is delivered to your door. When I escaped your country as foreigner, you wanted to deport me. When I need clothes, you bought branded clothes online for yourself. The postage alone costs, the postage cost alone is more than what I need in a month. When I was sick, you blamed my poverty that made me sick. When I was in prison, you said I got what I deserve. Now I want you to decide what or which version of Matthew 25 that more accurately describes your response to the poor, sick, widow, and orphan. What does God expect from us? You see, the gospel in God vision, the gospel is God's vision of a changed people who will challenge and transform the prevailing value and practices in our world. Jesus called this coming of the kingdom of God. He said it would become a reality through the life and deed of those who follow him. You see, Jesus challenged each one of us to embrace radically different standards. He challenged us to love our neighbor or our enemy, to forgive those who do wrong to us, to lift up the poor and the oppressed, to stand up for justice, to share what we have with those that have not enough. And he called us to live lives of sacrifice. You see, this is the call that is our gospel. This gospel should be a social revolution. And we, FGB men, should be standing on the front lines. The Apostle Paul wrote that we are Christ's ambassador called by God. You see, God chose us to be his representative. He called us, you and I, to go out to proclaim that good news, to be, literally be the good news. And he called us to change the world, not to live in the world looking for fame or looking for success. Mother Teresa once said, God does not call us to be successful. He called us to obey. Francis Chan said, our greatest fear should not be of failure, but of succeeding at things in life that don't really matter. Jefferson Bethke said, the greatest single cause of atheism in the world today is Christians who acknowledge Jesus with their mouth and walk out the door and deny him by their lifestyle. As you know, 2,000 years ago, a social and spiritual revolution was launched by only 12 people, and really changed the world. They are poor, they are educated, they are not educated. Jesus, with the leader of their movement, left them alone, actually, after his miraculous death and resurrections. They were hated by their own people. They were captives by the emperor. They had no budget, they had no asset, they had no roadmap, but they are called to go all over the world, to the end of the earth, to make disciples of all nations and be the good news. And against all odds, these 12 people believe that they can change the world. With the Christ in their heart and the marvelous power of the gospel on their lips. So what does God expect from us? You are here today. I believe there's a call for all of you to work on God's plan to change the world in your generation. Think about it. You are God's plan A, because God doesn't have plan B. Like that Indian kid named Lucky. You are all lucky. You are here today because you have a privilege to be used by God. In John 15, 16, it says, Jesus said, you did not choose me, but I choose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. Let me say one thing before I end this meeting or message. I've been saying to you to do this or do that, but I know some of us don't really like it. Some of you probably will say, well, religion only say do this and do that when Jesus say everything is done. I'm not here to judge you or to chuck more condemnation, more shame, more guilt, but telling you something that you know that you don't do. I don't think Jesus is saying to you, you must do this or must do that. But I believe one thing. I believe that he is inviting you to be the happiest man, the happiest people on earth. If you read that book by Demos Zakarian, you know, he believed that God has a gift in each one of you, some special ability to use for his kingdom. I believe if you find that gift and use it, you will be the happiest people on earth. But if we miss it, no matter how many excellent things we do, we will be utterly miserable. I repeat what Francis Chan said. Our greatest fear should not be of failure, but of succeeding at things in life that don't really matter. Let's discover God's purpose for you. Let's find that gift or special ability God has given you to advance his kingdom. Let's find that outlet for fulfilling the great commission. No matter how small, let's take that smallest baby step, 2%, 1%, whatever it is, take that baby step. My pastor, Barry Chan, always said, when we step out in faith, God will step in with power. The small step that we took, my wife and myself, the 2% we gave has taken us to a journey that we never, ever dream of. As we took our first baby step to serve him, we realized that God entrusted us with his mission. In the beginning, we asked God, God, how can you trust us, God? How can you call us, God? With all our shortcomings, with all our sins, with all our failure. And God saw us fail. He let us learn from our failure. He saw us struggle. He saw us broken. He saw us give up. But he let us get up and try again. He let us correct our mistake and grow from it. This is really a transformative experience. We learn so much leadership from Jesus. We learn to draw our strength from Holy Spirit. We learn to use the spiritual authority that was given by God. This is the experience that money cannot buy. Let me end this with a prayer, if I may. Heavenly Father, as we end this meeting soon, I pray that you begin now. You begin to transform our friends, our brothers and sisters that are listening right now into your likeness. With the power of your word, you will encourage, you will empower. So they, each one of them, will discover the best in them through you. With the power of the Holy Spirit, you will raise them up to their full potential. Lord, I ask God that all who are present now be given a full and meaningful life in serving you, O Lord. And you invite us to join this revolution, Lord. Make us a shining city upon a hill. Please use each and every one of us to change the world all over again in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I want to close this presentation with a march, a song from that is actually written for FGBMFI. And we as a group in Indonesia, in Australia, we sang along this song. The song is actually quite long, but I just want you to get the snippets of it. So allow me just to share this.
Let us hold our shield of faith, and the truth will set us free. Testify for the name of God.
Let him be man. He's strong in the Lord. He's strong in the Lord.
That saves, if we are the army of our God. When the rope is full of twists and the soap is
Thank you. All yours, Raymond.
Thank you, Brother Adam. I want to assure you that this is one of the best sessions I ever heard. And you move me in a very different way. We've been challenged. And wow, I don't know what to say. So I'm going to pass this mic to my vice president, Samuel. Could you please facilitate this Q&A sessions? Thank you so much.
Thank you, Brother Adam. You really blessed us this afternoon. So it's Q&A time. So if you have questions, please unmute or raise your hand and we'll be happy to have Adam, you know, answer you. Brother Adam, let me just start off. Yes, I agree with Brother Raymond, very inspirational. I can see why you are the FGBMFI Indonesian president, regional president out of Australia, if I got that correct. God's blessing on you. I mean, 11 years ago, you made that turn from that song, Hosanna.
Yeah.
And, you know, what came for me is you can only give what you have received, Brother Adam, and your commitment, you know. You have received hope, love, and God has touched you and you're now sharing with others. Are there times when you kind of felt discouraged? I'm sure there are many examples where you kind of said, hey, should I pull back? Or how did you keep your commitment all these years?
Well, there are so many moments which we felt very discouraged. As you know, serving the Lord is the easiest thing to do. I think I mentioned it as well when I came back from China. Myself and my wife said, this is not for us. You know, the challenge, we don't speak Chinese. We wanted to help. We prayed the prayer that we thought we're going to change someone's life. Nothing happened. We actually came back quite disappointed. And that's why we, you know, I'm trying to find myself by going to Halftime Institute. But again, there's so much encouragement that we receive in Halftime Institute as we draw the roadmap. You know, we had group of our friends that actually being very honest to us. And I remember the first month I draw a roadmap and thinking, this is what I want to be. This is what I am. And they asked me two questions. They said, okay, your roadmap is so good, but where is your wife in there? And where is Jesus in there? And I realized, you know, my first roadmap is all about me. It's all about me. So month after month, we change. We learn and we humble ourselves. And to get to the point where, yeah, we know, you know, everything is about God. God will release when the time comes. And, you know, like what I said as well in that sharing, as God allowed us to do, and we were so surprised, how can you entrusted us with a mission? How can you, even God entrusted me with FGBMFI region, Australia and New Zealand for Indonesian people? You know, I don't have that capacity. I don't have that capability. But with the power of the Holy Spirit, I guess anything is possible. Thank you. Thanks, Brother Samuel.
Amen. Amen. Yeah. And you know, God always works in a community, isn't it? And you getting the support of FGB and then taking, you know, trusting yourself and trusting God to do the rest. Okay, Brother Sebastian, you have a question?
Praise God. I'm just very curious, Brother Adam, you are Indonesian and you migrated to Australia. We just want to know a background. What caused you all to migrate? And just these details.
Okay. All right. Well, I actually didn't want to migrate. I actually wanted to help my mom and dad. They okay, but you know, I know they finance, and I didn't want to go. But one day I was driving and I was hit by this, the police officer, by the what do you call it, the stop sign, because I almost hit children that crossing the road, and then they pulled me out from the from the car, and pretty much I was habis. They just hit me, kicked me, and yeah, you know, Indonesia, they're pretty intense. I was I guess, yeah, I was different, and they, yeah, I was pretty much, I was hit, and then my dad said, look, you would not be able to survive in Indonesia, because I had such a bad temper at the time too. So my dad decided to give me a one-way ticket to Sydney, and there I was.
Interesting, yeah. Wow. Any other questions? Anyone have a question for Brother Adam Tedja? Please feel free to unmute. Any questions?
From different continents, you can pick.
Okay, Brother Adam Tedja.
Yes.
I'm truly inspired. And thank you for playing that FGB song. And you know, it's truly inspirational. And your experience, and almost brought tears to my eyes, your visit to India. The love that you show, you know, to the children, we can feel that, you know, how genuine your love for the children and for God's children. And, you know, it's awesome. So I just want to ask you, how often do you play this song? Do you play this FGB song every meetings? Or those are my questions. Thank you.
Okay, that song was written by a guy by the name of Rudy Santoso from Surabaya. So it's actually originally was written in Bahasa Indonesia. So in Indonesia, they have this, I guess every meeting, depending which chapter, they love to play the FGBMFI march as one of the song that, I guess it just waken up our spirit. So it started like that. And then chapter after chapter, they started to do their own version in Bahasa. But then I felt like we need to do one in English. And the composer wrote another version in English, and I was so inspired by it. So we decided to have our own Australian version as well. And that's when we started doing it during, you know, we actually took photo or video of each one of us using our mobile phone and compose it as one. So praise the Lord, we got something. And we played, I guess, irregularly we do, but we love to play that song. It brings a really kind of spirit. Sometimes I even said this is a song of deliverance. For us, it is a song of deliverance, the song that coming out of the Southland of the Holy Spirit, Australia.
Amen.
Thank you, sir.
All right. Thank you.
Any other questions? I don't see anyone or anything on the chat. So, Brother Adam, can I just take the opportunity to ask another question? So,
you
were a follower of, I suppose, Buddha or some other religion. You had altars.
Yep.
And your wife and daughter, if I understood correctly, were Christians first.
That's right. Yeah.
What was that like? I mean, this pushy Singaporean who kept talking about Jesus to you.
my daughter and my son, actually, they're very evangelical. They go to this Wesley International Methodist Church, but they're very evangelical. And they wanted me to know Jesus for a long, long time, probably 4 or 5 years, but I was quite happy to at that time to follow my old religion. And they asked me one question: what would it take to change you? And I said, I believe Jesus when I see him. And true enough, I believe I heard that the whole church praying for me. And I believe that when they had that the camp, the ladies' camp, they were all praying for me. And this lady, Adeline from Singapore, she received a vision and she tricked me by coming to my house and encountered me and then pushed me. But I was, I guess at that time when she pushed me in the kitchen, I already received the revelation, but I was too proud. I was too proud. I said no 3 times.
Wow. Wow.
But I know, you know, I at the end, that night, that day, exactly as she prophesied, I accepted Jesus. That was 30th of October 2009.
Amazing, amazing. And what God has done. Yeah, so it's interesting, huh? How that happened. And the prayer already had started doing work in the spiritual realm and maybe in you, but you were too proud to give in. Finally, God touched you. Amen. Praise God for that.
Yeah, praise God.
Any other questions from anyone? So we're at, what's the time now? About past one, if you have no questions. So I think...
Yeah, question, I believe.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I think there are questions from the... Ask them from the Aussie side.
Do you see questions, Raymond? Or you are suggesting someone from Australia ask a question? Yes. Anyone? Yeah. I think, you know, one of the things that I think for all of us here, I guess people are quiet because they're reflecting. It's you challenged us to use that 2%, right? Or, yeah. You know, whether it's 2% or 98%. I think what I personally, if I may share, is, you know, how am I using the privileges and opportunities God has given to serve him? And I think sometimes you can't give what you don't have.
Yeah.
In your case, you received hope, you received meaning, you became the happiest man on earth. And you want to share that with others and you want to give that out. So it's like, you know, I'm just reflecting, how am I using my privileges and opportunities? What about you, men? Any or ladies, any thoughts on that? Just open. Anyone? Especially
I pick Jennifer.
Okay, Raymond's picking people now, so
Jennifer no Hongi. Better half of...
I have a question for Brother Adam.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah.
From who?
Brother Adam, in your introduction, you mentioned about the church and also the kingdom of God. How do you... how are the churches united in tandem in the these last days in the kingdom move, the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven? How are we going to best utilize this move where the churches all over the world are united in this this movement, the kingdom of God?
Thank you. I think your question is too hard for me. I'm a marketplace person. You probably need to ask Len Donaldson. Len, help.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Len. You want to have...
Unmute yourself, Len.
I think history is our teacher. The church prospers under persecution. And I think what's happening worldwide is the church has been put to the sword. And it's going to draw us together and it's going to make us stronger. And people say to me, is the church going to go through tribulation? And I said, well, just read Jeremiah 30. These are the times of Jacob's troubles. And it's in these troubling times that we get strengthened because we push into God and people remember again how to pray. And once you get the ear of God, the Holy Spirit moves And I think we're going to see revival worldwide.
Amen.
I really do.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Len. You saved my life.
Bless you, brother. I love you.
Len, what about the falling away, you know, when persecution comes, when your life is at stake and so on, right? And it gets tougher. We don't know what 2022 and forward will bring. But the word says that there will be a great falling away, great deception and so on.
I think that's true. The scripture is true, and there will be a falling away. And I think we've experienced the falling away in a lot of our churches here in Australia, because the gospel that is being preached is a passive gospel. Paul said, I don't come to you with the eloquence of word. I come with the demonstration of the power of God. Now, each one of us, the happiest men on the earth, have the power of God. And we can change the situation. And, you know, there's that old chorus, bind us together, Lord, bind us together with cords of love that cannot be broken. And when the body of Christ, you know that book, The Sleeping Giant, when the body of Christ stands as one man against evil, then we'll see revival like we can't imagine. We've got to be reading the word. We've got to be reading the word daily. Yep.
Thank you, Brother Lena, Brother Adam. Any other questions, anyone? Any thoughts, anything you want a clarification? It's 2:10. If there isn't any, I don't want to prolong it. I know some people have already signed up. We have 63 still here. Just last round, anyone? Otherwise, I'll pass it to Brother Raymond.
Well,
okay.
Thank you so much, Brother Samuel. You did well. Wonderful. And Brother Adam, you did not disappoint. Truly, truly, we need to hear heart message on a regular basis. Like Brother Len said, you know, yeah, we got to stay strong, stay obedient to the Lord in this last day. I don't think God, you know, allowed this pandemic to happen for no purposes, for no objective whatsoever. He reminded us not to waste our salvations.
Yes.
Preach the gospel, command, obey the commandment.
Correct.
Yeah. Yeah. Go out, because this is exactly the time the light of Jesus shined the brightest in the darkest day, in the last day. Hallelujah. Praise be to God. Thank you, Brother Adam, for that reminder. Thank you so much. So I'd like to ask Pastor Leonard to pray for this in closing, and pray that we will stay strong in the Lord. Hallelujah.
Father, we just rejoice in the richness of your blessing. Lord, your blessing has been on our speaker today. And Lord, as he spoke your word out, oh Lord God, with boldness and authority, Lord, it has touched the hearts of the hearers, and Lord, transforming us, oh Lord God, drawing us together, making us stronger, fortifying us, oh Lord God, against the evil day in which we live. And Father, we know that the scripture says that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. And Lord, we draw on your Holy Spirit, Lord, as we hear your word proclaimed. Lord, our brother Adam, Lord, proclaimed your word with the authority of the Holy Spirit and in Jesus' name. And Father, we just pray blessing back on him. Lord, blessing on his chapters, oh Lord God, blessings on all those things that he turns his hands to do. Lord, and for those that heard the word today, Lord, yes, let it permeate in their hearts, oh yes, Lord God. Lord, let it boil up until they're speaking in the marketplace.
Yes,
Lord, the good news that Jesus came to save the lost. Mm-hmm. Father, we pray in Jesus' lovely name. Amen.
Amen.